today in the workshop, I make a clamping plate which bolts onto the milling machine spindle so I can use this to hold the sensor on the direct readout. This is the plate. It consists of a 10mm thick plate, and I've clamped it onto a face plate in the lathe to bore the 93mm hole. Using my rotary head, I've held this in a chuck and machined the outside. So we'll see how the rotary head performs on machining some aluminium. And then that gives me this point here, which has got two tapped holes in, for holding the direct readout on the Z-axis. So let's go into the workshop, see how we make it.
Well, today I'm doing some faceplate work. I've just set this block of aluminium up on the lathe using these four clamps just to hold it in position, and you can see where I've just touched the tool. I want to cut a 90mm hole in this plate. I looked at doing it on the milling machine, and the boring head will only go up to about 60-70mm. The only other way to do it, as I can get this on the swing, and the problem with the swing is when you bring the saddle in, at the bottom here on the saddle, you've got to make sure I've got about 4mm clearance on the casting of the saddle here. You see this just clears the saddle. That's 89, so I don't want to go any bigger than that. I want to try and cut through. And what I'm having to do is make the groove, the slot wider as I'm going deeper, so that the tool has not got all the pressure in the one area. Over 10mm the depth, so I think what's happened is I've cut through and it's just pushed the aluminium back into the centre. Yeah, it's cut through at the bottom here. I'll put my boring bar in, see if I can get that better finish. It's in 1963. I'm just going to go in. I'm not going to put a cut on, I'll just go in, just clean it. There's two T-bolts that I lost in the middle. You see the shape I'm going to cut out next on the bandsaw. Just cut this out down there. This is my bandsaw and I'm just resetting the blade to cut this aluminium we've just machined. I'm making sure that the two discs that come in each side of the blade, which are on a bearing, and not rubbing the blade all the time. So if I tighten this one up and lock it, you'll see as the blade goes through, the discs are rubbing, turning all the time. So if I slacken it off a bit, that's what I want. So the blade goes through and they only rub when the blade moves left or right to guide the blade. And you notice that the blade teeth are well away from the discs, because if you set the blade too far back, these teeth will go into the middle and all you'll be doing is flattening the teeth on the side of the disc. And this bearing at the back, that's there to stop the blade going backwards as you put force from the front. So normally as it goes around, it shouldn't be touching that bearing. That bearing only comes into play when there's force put on the blade. You see now it's moving. Without any force, it shouldn't be moving. So if you've got this engaged all the time, you're pushing the blade forward. And if these are engaged all the time, you're either bending it either way. Now under the table, so I can get this piece out. The bottom there, I don't know if you can see, right down the bottom, just at the end of the ruling side there, there are two wooden guides and they do exactly the same as the metal guides at the top. They're to stop the blade moving left or right. I've just set those, so just missing the blade, put that in. The next thing to do, obviously if I've got the blade is brought right up, you've got a big gap here, this blade is going to flex in between, so you need to lower the guard just above the thickness of the work that you're going to cut, so you can get the work under there without touching the guard. And that cuts the gap down then. I can close this. So that's reduced the gap, so there's less likelihood of the blade moving. I'll just shut the door. Vibration with it, and the reason for that is the stepper motor belt is moving backwards and forwards slightly. I just touch this, takes it out. What's happening with the cutter going round, this has got a little bit of play in it, so the cutter's pushing it back and the motor's trying to pull it forward, so we get that vibration set up. But the finish, you see from that, is very good. The other thing I definitely need is a lock, because the motor, when I want to lock it in position, for example, I can bring it round to this part. Now if I could lock that at 90 degrees, I'd come in and just come down there with the cutter on the face. But because I can't lock the spindle and the stepper motor is, you've got that little bit of play in it, I think I might be able to take that up on the belt by adjusting the tension a bit more. But if I had a spindle lock on there, I could just lock it, machine the flat faces, and then do the radius. But you can see on that, I'm pleased with the finish. So it's sort of 50-50, it's working, not quite there yet. And what I have to do now is, all I'm doing is using the A axis on the CNC. You've got X, Y, Z, and then you go on to rotary axis A, B, C. I've wired this up as the A axis, so although I've got my computer on in the background, the CNC's on, but it's not running. All I'm using is the one axis to control the stepper motor in this head. This will be ideal with a spindle lock. If you're doing a dividing plate, because you're just coming down, you're not fighting the chuck as it's moving, so the backlash problem wouldn't be there. You would just drive it one way, lock it, drill. You might not even need to lock it, because going down you're not pushing the chuck either way. But it's getting there. I've got an idea for putting a spindle lock on there, so I don't think there's too much of a problem. There's plenty of room in the box to fit it. What I want to do now is come in with this. That's 29 degrees. Get down. Let's lift the spindle up, test it. So I want to go from 0 to 29 degrees. Rotating it with the computer to see where it will go. This speed is running at 60 millimeters minute. I'm tapping a 6mm by 1 thread. So that's nearly finished now. I've got two screws here which will hold another piece on. That screw goes through. All I need to do is split that by using the bandsaw to cut across. Now here's the finish ring on top of the original depth stop. This part you can alter for your setting your depth of your drill. And what I've done is just bolt on this ring that we've just made above, so that on this side it gives me a piece jutting out. I've now got this platform here.
Oh well, that's it for today. I hope that was interesting, hope it's useful, and we'll see you next time on Enots Engineering.